here. I'm here in the city. I'm in Union Square. Jenny?
Lucy.
Oh my God! Hi!
We gotta forget everything that happened, all right? Whatever you said, whatever I said, we gotta forget it, get over it. I don't want another 3 years to go by like this. Oh my God! Look at this place! It's crazy awesome! Oh, I love this couch! Oh. What are you doing here? No, you can't have a dog here.
Don't worry, he's a dog, but he's not a dog.
Why are you here? Since when do you come to the city?
Well, are you visiting friends?
This would be perfect! I would really like to stay here for a couple of days.
Hello.
Hi, I'm Lucy, by the way.
Bill.
My sister.
Oh, you're that Lucy. Well, welcome to New York, Jenny's sister.
I really like him. He looks like Superman.
God damn it, how could she do this to me?
I didn't know this would be so dramatic for you.
She didn't tell you?
What are we gonna do with her?
Well, we could ask her to move the fort.
Day's coming up, right?
Muscle. Remember, you never know real happiness until you get married. And then it's too late.
We want to keep it very intimate and small.
How small?
Just family.
So don't tell Mom.
You went to a hell of a lot of trouble to get rid of your family, Jennifer.
Shh. You're like a different person with him. Why? People grow up, Lucy. You should try it.
You are trying to pass. You're trying to be something that you're not.
This is who I am. Get used to it.
Don't be mad at me, okay?
I love you.
What made you come down, Lucy?
I need you to hear me. I love you.
It's so great to hear you. It's so sweet.
So, now I'd like to talk about tonight's film because I was incredibly
excited. Oh, God, no. Do it! She's an orphan!
And I would love to know what started the whole idea for this film.
Rich produced it, and he's my partner in everything that you've heard about here, so I'll have him start telling the story of how this movie came to be, which was very odd.
Yeah, this was an odd film. This movie started on a dare, literally. Netta Armian, who's my co-producer, who you know well.
Yes.
And Mary Tobler.
Yes.
Who is also a friend. Netta, Mary, and Nancy were having coffee one day, talking about another project that we have together, the four of us. It's a fantastic project, but it's been 8 years in hell, not being able to get it made. And they were just complaining, and Netta just sort of threw
it out. We get a lot of things done by whining.
Yes, we do.
Rivertown Film Society, because we were whining.
Yes.
So I recommend whining.
Good.
It's really good.
So Netta said, why don't you guys write something that we could shoot in my apartment? And the big mistake, don't do that, because that's what happened. So Mary and Nancy set out to...
if anybody wants us to shoot in their house,
yeah, we'll write a script for that too. So Mary and Nancy set out to write a script, and I loved the idea of seeing just how low we could set the bar, how inexpensively we could make a feature film. And so that was in, I guess, April of 2010, and I just said, great, we're shooting and it's greenlit, and we start November 1st, and we're going to shoot for 10 days. We did.
What, 10 days?
Yeah, but
no,
we
went over schedule. We shot 12.
We shot in 12 days.
12? That was shot in 12 days.
And also what Netta did not tell us was that her apartment, she offers her apartment. It's one room big. So everything you saw there was one room. Even the bedroom was a fake. And you'll appreciate that. It was just a corner of that one room that you constantly saw throughout the whole thing. So that was the parameters. Like, tell a story basically in one room.
And
that's
and,
affordable.
And so,
not a lot of cast.
And so Nancy pulled something out of the drawer, which was just a scene, basically the opening of the breakdown of this character out on the street, the very public meltdown, was something that you had witnessed partially.
I actually witnessed a train ride on the Metro North train that somebody was on the phone behind me and having a conversation. And like all of us, you know, we have to be aware that, do you remember this, that whenever you're on the phone, you're
Everyone here is in public.
Like, sometimes we remember and sometimes we forget. And I appreciate that this woman behind me forgot. And she was having one half of a conversation, and I just kept listening, and I realized that the person on the other end was trying to disassociate themselves from her. And my heart went out to her because she didn't realize it. And then I sort of followed a little bit, and then I just said, I can't follow it too much more. And then I just went home and wrote the story and just made it into my own. But it ended up being a lot. I realized, like, this Rossellini movie called Amore, where Anna Magnani's on the phone, and the short film is only about Anna Magnani on the phone breaking up with her married lover, and you see just her side of the conversation. You barely hear him, but you know what's happening with her. And I thought, that's just an incredible thing to just be with one character and just stay with them for that. So that was the opening I had.
So Mary Tobler said, great, that's the opening. Now, how do we get her into Netta's apartment?
That was the challenge.
And who lives there
Who's going to have to decide whether they open the door or not to this person? And then we realized it would have to be someone that can't not open the door.
Right.
You know, and that's the relationship. Whatever that relationship, they cannot get away with not opening the door. And then we have a movie.
Right.
Yeah.
So then Mary wrote the script, and you co-wrote it.
Mary was in Washington, I was in New York, and we just basically emailed all summer long.
Right.
And had a great time. Like, wow. I never knew what she was going to come up with. She never knew what I was... We never knew what each other was going to come up with, because we didn't have a plan as to how it was going to work out. So the story actually kind of wrote itself. Like, then the characters came to life, and then they started dictating what they would do and would not do. So then we just had to follow, you know, what they were doing. And, yeah.
And the selection of your cast, how did that happen?
Well, you want to talk about it?
Well, I mean, I think that we were very lucky that Nancy thought Mira would be perfect for that role. And
but it made me very nervous, because if she said no, I really didn't have anyone else
to go to.
I mean, it was like Mira.
And honestly, our casting director sent it to her agent, and it was a greenlit movie.
Really?
Yes, at slave wages, because you made it greenlit. You greenlit your own movie.
Yeah. All right. Every movie
Which
maker out there, listen to
this. Business understands, you wait for years for some, the movie gods from on high to greenlight your movie, and this was one where we said we're going to make it so simple that we can greenlight it.
Yeah. So we had a start date. It was a small commitment, and thankfully she read the script and responded to it.
So, Rich, because you're such an incredible genius with maneuvering numbers around on the page, how much?
Hopefully,
did this...
I won't get caught. But
can I ask you how much this movie cost to make?
Sure. I'm actually quite proud of it, because I can't quite believe it when I watch it. All in, including all the music licensing, this cost $188,000.
And be aware that when we started...
I'm sorry.
When we started shooting, we didn't have that
Yeah, we
money.
Never actually had $188,000.
We started with very little, and all we knew is that if we could just shoot it, then we could keep showing it and raising more money.
Yeah, and the big expense, I mean, like about 40% of that is actually the music licensing, because those songs are not
Musics
cheap.
Are but, very... Yeah. Music yeah. is
Rich had a big headache when he saw the music I wanted to use.
Yes.
Blame it on the bossa nova. I'm like, oh my God.
No, that was innocent. That was the innocent director saying, oh, we just need something for the kids to dance. Let's just put this on. And I heard it and I said, don't play that, because you're going to want it. And she said, no, it's just now. It's just temporary.
That's my ploy. I always say that.
So in your pocket, when you first started, rolling camera, how much did you have?
We probably had about $70,000.
Okay.
That got us through shooting.
Amazing.
And then post, and then post, the music licensing and the deliverables and all of
but
that.
But that's
what,
I mean, the credits for such a short movie, the credits are long, because we give so many thank yous, because, the poster that you see for this film was done on good faith.
Yeah.
The trailer, when you go online and see the trailer for this film, it was done by a professional company that makes trailers. It was done on good faith. I mean, everyone that helped us on this film just did it because they saw the film and they saw something in it and they thought that they eventually would get paid. We're waiting.
But it was a tight, so, we're still waiting, yes.
Well, but you know, it's that kind of commitment that it was really incredibly touching.
Yeah. Well, it has so much heart, and when you see it, I mean, obviously, I mean, this is always the kind of worry is, okay, you send a script out, and then who knows who reads it, when they read it, right. Why ever they read it. Right. They probably don't read it. They pass on things, and they don't even, you know, agents probably hate scripts like this because they're, you know, they're not going to make any money. Right. You know, the whole paradigm of how movies get made in this country has become, you know, something of a farce because wonderful films like this have such a limited chance of coming alive, except for the fact that you have the courage to get out there and, as an artist, to do your work with the limited funds that you have. How long was the shoot? 12 days.
It was 12 days, but I have to say, I mean, people will often say, "Would you do this again?" You know, and my answer is, I guess if we have to do it again, we would do it again, but it's certainly not a model to follow all the time.
No.
Because
no. Don't do this
people,
at home.
No, people were paid minimum wage.
Yeah. The crew got minimum wage.
These were people that were incredibly talented and skilled artisans, and they were paid minimum wage. So if we make money one day, they will see more money. But it's not sustainable.
No.
So it's not something that, and I feel a responsibility to say this, that this is not a model. Like, so if the people in the movie industry go, oh, great, we can make them cheaper. No, we can't, because we can't survive doing it this way. But it was a movie just that we needed to make ones. Plus, we burnt out all our wonderful, you know, friendships because we kept asking favors from everybody. So like people
so it's
going to
take a while
like,
to make some new friends.
I'm not taking a call anymore. You know, it's like every time I'm calling, I'm asking for a favor.
I'm not taking the dog tonight.
Yeah. The dog they didn't need to take because he was in the movie.
That's our dog.
So that was our dog. So we actually did not need dog sitters while we were shooting because we actually just employed him for less than minimum wage.
Yes.
Please don't let anybody know that.
He
just worked for treats.
But the idea that you can do something this remarkable in 12 days, I mean, that means that the commitment from an actor or anybody is only 12 days.
Yes.
So it's not like you're signing away your life to something that's going to...
There was a week of rehearsal, and the original commitment was a week of rehearsal and 2 weeks of shooting.
Yeah.
And, you know, Mary came to us very early on. Well, the first thing she did was look me in the eye and say, have you ever made a movie, a feature film in 10 days? And I said, no, but I have a plan. And she was great about it. She said, you know, she basically said, look, I'm available for the next week if you want to, you know, if we don't finish. And everybody was really, you know.
And you have to understand, Mira Sorvino, who has now 4 little kids, but at the time had 3 little kids, you know, paying her babysitter to take care of the kids while she was working kind of wiped out the salary we had for her. Do you know what I mean? It's really,
was
when
that
you
her
think
son?
About That was her son.
I knew it.
I'm not that good a director.
I
can't stop a baby from crying except their mother.
When I saw that, seriously, when I saw that, I said to Susanna, it's got to be her son. He's going, mommy, mommy.
Yeah. And then suddenly he hits her shoulder
and he's out.
Yeah, that's a kid.
That was brilliant.
Yes.
I mean, you never...
And plus, doesn't he look like a mini Paul Sorvino?
He did.
If you look at his face.
He did. His mouth, everything.
Yeah.
No, but you know, it's like the classic thing. Don't do a movie with children or dogs.
And we deliberately put in children and dogs.
Yes. But they were friends.
Yeah, exactly.
They all knew each other.
Exactly. No, we're shameless movie. But what gets an audience? Babies and dogs. Okay, we'll put them in.
So before I let some people here ask questions, what was the most challenging day of the shoot?
Every one of the 12 days.
Yes. I don't know.
Were they long days? They couldn't have been.
They
that
weren't
long.
Especially long.
No, they
long.
Couldn't be. We couldn't burn people out. We were working so intensely. We prepared very well.
Yeah.
So that we couldn't go that long. We were very well prepared. But I think the challenge was magically lifted when our first assistant director, Glenn Trotner, who's one of our co-producers, he had so many years of experience doing this. So we were a mix of like very young crew that had less experience but lots of energy, and us older crew that had less energy but more experience. And the two of us together worked really well because our first AD took a look at the script and he started breaking it down because his job is to schedule everything. And then when I saw the first draft he had of a schedule, I realized that the scene numbers We're almost in numerical order. And if anyone here works on film, you understand that that's really rare in the film business.
So rare.
Because you have to shoot in the order of usually whether the locations dictate, right. You know, the availability of a location dictates. Right. Oh, we're shooting in the family house the first 2 weeks, and then we're moving to the garage, and then we're moving to the restaurant scenes and whatever. So you shoot out of order all the time, and actors are used to that. In our case, because we owned this location of this apartment, and all the other locations were within walking distance, literally we would pack the cameras in like bags and walk over. We had one van.
One minivan.
For transportation, we had nothing. So we were able to shoot in locations and come back home to Netta's house. We shot in numerical order, which means that day one of shooting, Mira Sorvino has a nervous breakdown.
Yeah.
Day two of shooting, she rings the doorbell and sees her sister. In a real movie production, she would ring the doorbell, see her sister, and then 3 weeks later have a nervous breakdown. Right. How big was her nervous breakdown? Was she hysterical crying? Was she shaking? Or was she like just a little crying? That's a trick that an actor has to play in their head before they make that decision of ringing the doorbell to their sister's house. Right. If they haven't shot their scene, they don't know where they were.
Right.
That we make it up. And we do this all the time in film. But on this movie, she really had her breakdown day one. Day two, she rang the bell. She knew exactly where she was on day one. She just continued.
Yeah.
And all these revelations, all these character revelations that you learn, happened in chronological order for shooting, which never happens on film.
Which brings me to the next thing, which is equipment.
Mm-hmm.
Because oftentimes with film, you know, you're just sort of shackled with a lot of lights and what have you.
I fought every piece of equipment. I fought the number of sandbags. Why do we need six sandbags?
Let's take four.
We really, wasn't just that I'm insane and cheap and all that, but we had no place to put it.
Right.
The gear had to live overnight in the location, and then we'd come in the morning and put all the gear out in the
hallway where there were other neighbors,
which
ready
we weren't
to
supposed
yell at
to be doing.
We were like in their
so
way.
It was yeah.
So it so was we, really.
And the camera that you used.
We shot the film on a. We shot the movie on a still camera, the Canon 5D.
Yeah, wow. Yeah.
Two of them.
Yeah. Which is why you'll see, but we said, okay, we're going with it. It is the language of this movie. That there were, you know, there were focus problems in this movie. And we just decided, okay, there are focus problems in this movie, and this is the way we're telling our story because.
Yeah, because at the time there were a number of technical limitations that are now. I mean
at
that was
time,
that was the camera in vogue
right
at the moment.
Yeah.
Now it's kind of passé. But one of the issues was that the operator had to handle their own focus.
Sorvino running around an apartment and you're pulling focus as you're shooting.
So they're shooting and pulling focus at the same
really
time.
Hard.
So.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
And you had one camera, two cameras?
We had two cameras.
Two.
Sometimes, once we had three.
Yeah.
And you ran them always at once, all at once?
Yeah, yeah.
And you didn't, I mean, your lighting setups were such that you didn't have to.
Well, we, in the editing room, we found a couple of nightstands and stuff. And again, everything is, technology allowed us to make this movie because then we were able to like blow the shot up, like right in the editing room. Whereas, in the past, you'd wait till you get to the final and then send it off to some effects. No, we were like blowing up the shot so we could get rid of the equipment that was in, you know, sometimes. And you actually, if you ever see this movie again, it's like, where's Waldo?
When you
look for the
DVD.
Camera. Look for the camera because there is a giant shot of a camera right in your face.
It takes
in this
up
movie.
About 2/3 of the frame.
And it's an optical illusion that you don't see it. It took me several months to see it, and I stopped. And my editor didn't see it, and I stopped the frame and I said, "There's a camera in the shot," but like, you know, half the frame is a camera.
Yeah.
So one day for fun, you'll look for a camera, and then please send me an email and tell me where you found it, and you'll win a prize. That and continuity issues, we were playing around with things and it's so fascinating that when you're emotionally involved in a movie, you can get away with murder.
Well, a lot of those things fall away.
Yeah.
Because of the style of what you were doing.
It was
which
the
was
wacky style,
very
right.
handheld and very it was very almost like home movies.
Yes.
That feeling and the focus thing, you that's okay because it's what else is going on that's
so hoped that you would be so involved you wouldn't notice our mistakes. Yes.
Yeah.
We
well hope. I think that was I want to open it up. Do you have any questions? Oh, wow. Okay. Yes.
Hold on.
Uh-oh.
The interior film, which happens on the kids and the reaction shots, is very effective, and I was curious when during the course
of shooting. Oh, the interior film with Patti LuPone and the kids and the reaction shots is very affecting, very effective. And I was just giving the emotions that are portrayed. When in the sequence of filming did you shoot the interior film?
What day was it?
Oh, I don't know. It was sometime in the second week.
Maybe day 8 or 9. I mean,
honestly, I can't quite place it because we actually shot Patti. All the Patti scene was shot in less than an hour. So
yeah, we shot that in 45 minutes.
I can't remember when, but I think the real point was, first of all, Mira actually shot that.
Why didn't it's true? We made a mistake. We didn't give her credit for shooting that. She was our camera.
She actually shot it.
She was the operator.
Yeah, she shot it.
Wow. She took the camera and shot that. And then, which made a huge difference for her and Patti talking to each other like that.
But none of the actors actually saw it. No one saw it. Tammy didn't see it at all until that moment when she was.
So when you guys watch the actors watching the video, they're watching it for the first time.
Oh, wow.
They've never seen it before. Yeah. Yeah. So that's why you get the reaction that you get.
Oh, wow. Amazing. I'm sorry. Yes. Yes.
Hold on. Wait.
Oh, yeah. I thought it was a very interesting and moving film. I was seeing in the credits that you had a psychology consultant. And obviously there was a lot of family dynamics and breakdowns going on, but I'm wondering what that person was used for.
It was really interesting because everything, again, evolved incredibly organically. Mary Tobler and I were batting this story back and forth, and the more it evolved, the more we found that at the heart of this crisis was someone having a breakdown. Again, things evolved. This mom who had been suicidal throughout her life, finally committing suicide before she dies of her illness. And all these dynamics. And we wrote it just from the heart. We just wrote it. And then I said to Mary, I said, I'm going to just check with a couple of psychologists to see, because I think this might be what people call bipolar disorder. Mm. And my minor in college was psychology, so I'm one of those people that has that dangerous little bit of knowledge. I have a little bit of knowledge. But as someone who's interested in performance and characters, I'm always interested in their psychology. So I consulted with two different psychologists on it and just talked a lot about what's symptomatic and what's not and what's appropriate and not. And frighteningly, we got them all right. So Mary and I really know our stuff when it comes to bipolar disorder. So, and another thing I want to talk about is that Rich always made this joke within Friends that we weren't manic depressive until we joined the film business, because the film business is very much about like being like, oh my God, you've got a job and you get all this money, make a movie, or you lost the money, you're nowhere. You know, so within like a few minutes, your life can change like this. And that's really true, and that wreaks havoc on your emotions. And so that kind of lifestyle and that kind of experience was something that we were all really familiar with. And to me, it was interesting to examine and not place judgment on, but just examine when this is something that is sort of chronic and whatever, or when it's just an episode in your life that comes and goes, and how interesting it is that we label it. It's something we're not very comfortable with, our mental illness episodes, if they're episodes or if they're lifetime, because, and the way we know we're not really comfortable with them is because the name for them keeps changing. So if today it's bipolar disorder, a few years ago it was manic depression. Mm-hmm. A few years before that, I know when I was a kid, my mom had a nervous condition, you know, and then in the turn of the century, women were hysterical. So, or chemical imbalances. We have so many names for them that it means that, I think it's part of our life here on Earth. And, the things that happen to us as we sort of are on our journey, and some people get handed bigger lessons than others and we might react different. But this movie, I think, was about trying to put that in a story so people can bring their stuff to it.
mm-hmm. and then whatever with it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah? I'm sorry. Oh.
Hold on.
Sorry? Oh, getting the mic.
Hi, my name is Tom Balsamitis. I enjoyed the film.
Thank
greatly.
You.
And I'm a filmmaker locally, and I have a movie out with John Bell. He's a screenwriter. I was a producer and director called Hunting Season, and we cast Michael Cervino in it. Ah. So we're very
we
friendly.
We just met him the other day. He's
we're
a
very
great
friend.
Guy.
Yeah. We were at the festival this weekend. We were with Michael and Paul and Lorraine, so we're friendly with the family. But we love the movie, and I heard a lot about you. That's why I came out tonight to see it, and I thought it was great.
Thank you.
But my question is, a question that I get often is, do you have a distribution plan in place?
Oh, you're, that's a good question. Here we are.
This is it, right?
You are it. You are it.
Okay. Well, I mean, I didn't know if you had a, you know, because it's difficult to get the,
well, it's
you get the aggregators and everything, so.
Well, it's almost impossible, to be honest. I mean, the plan was, you know, if you thought too much about the plan before you started, you probably wouldn't have greenlit your own movie. But the plan was just to make the best movie we could and get it to the festivals and see what happens. And, you know, in the back of, again, I'm a little kooky and I wanted to, I kind of wanted this experience. I wanted to see how far we could go, you know, sort of on our own in a way. So we went to, you know, the film premiered at the Toronto Film Festival last year, 2011.
Saw that.
And did a few other festivals, and there was, you know, there was interest, but not a great deal, to be honest. There was a company that was really aggressive, a new company that was really aggressive and strong, you know, came after us, and we started negotiating with them, and then it turned out they didn't have any money. Not, forget about money to as an advance, but no money to actually even release the film.
Release in advertising. Did you see what Ed Burns did as far as his?
Yeah, I'm. Yeah, okay. I do. I know. Ed.
You know
so the plan then became to hire our hire our own distributor. We parceled off rights. The first thing we sold was the VOD, you know, video on demand, and we went to Toronto having already made a commitment for that, and we raised the P&A money, prints and ads, you know, marketing money, released the film theatrically. It opened in about 20 cities, from there it's now on demand, and it's going to be on Showtime around Thanksgiving.
Oh, perfect.
And then
perfect.
DVD and Netflix early next year, and we're now selling foreign as we go.
Congratulations, that's great.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes.
Wait a second.
First of all, I think you both are amazing. I thought it was brilliant. I love reading books about dysfunctional families. And I guess
you're in the right place.
I guess I can relate to that. And I like the idea of seeing siblings from different perspectives. You can grow up in the same household and you see things differently. Mm-hmm. I like the way Jenny transitioned. And I just thought it was amazing.
Thank you.
I really hope that you get wide, wide coverage.
Thank you so
much. And acknowledgement. Good luck.
Thank you. Yes.
I just had a quick question. You mentioned you started working for John Sayles, who's one of the great low-budget artists of all time. And he came in here and he spoke about how he designs a film from the get-go to, from a budgetary point of view. How much did your experience with him inform your production on this?
I think over the years, you know, even with our first film, you know, we showed our script to John and Maggie when we were, you know, kids out of college and had, because True Love took us 6 years to make, and it was 6 years after I graduated from film school. So I think they were our mentors, and they get the thank yous all the time because they're supportive all the time every time we come out to make another movie. So I think very much for me, I know that when I first worked with them, I really was paying attention to how Yes, they were working on low budgets, but they also, there was an incredible respect for crew and cast that came from the top down. So their whole MO and their whole way and their whole belief in what they were doing was something that we really, I think, took to heart and, you know, certainly informed how we do, you know, in our own way, do that as well.
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, that's the best lesson to learn. I mean, that, as you know, I mean, you know, working in the business is how you learn the business, and I think we learned, you know, it was tremendous learning experience from them. That first film, Brother from Another Planet, was, you know, $350,000, and it was John's money, and you know, it's that kind of, you know, spirit that he brought. And still brings. He just made a very small movie in L.A. So yeah.
Still continuing to, you know, just the point is that you have a story you want to tell, and you hope, you know, you want to give it to an audience. It's something like you just need to give this story out, and that's, you know, and I think we have that same feeling about what we do.
I have a question, just quickly. Yes.
You didn't know I was going to be the last question.
What did you say that threw you off like that? Oh, my God.
No. I guess the big dilemma is always to get it to a place where you have a cast that you feel can do the work mm-hmm. with you. Mm-hmm. And obviously, and you just said if you hadn't gotten Mira, you're not sure that you could have even made the film. Is that true? I mean, do you think you would have just packed it all in if you hadn't gotten her to do it?
Wow, that's a really good question, and I wish I knew the answer answer it honestly. I don't know. I just know that, you know, the way this is written, this story is written very extreme, yeah. And you need an actor of a certain caliber to take that extreme and not make it a caricature.
Right.
So it was a great, great, great concern of mine. So I don't know the answer. On the other hand, you know, we want to make films. The only thing I could tell you, which is it's a terrible secret, but the secret to getting that cast, at least for us, the cast that we wanted, was the fact that we were a movie that truly was going to get made. So the fact that we had a budget that was so manageable so that we could figure out a way to, you know, maybe not technically finish it, but get it made to the point where we could cut it and show it to more investors and get more money. You know, it's piecemeal and it's everyone acting on faith, but for the actors to know that it's actually going to happen. I mean, the biggest problem we've all had over the years, and many of us who are filmmakers have had this problem, we're not the only ones, is that, you know, we'll have a terrific project, terrific story, but the climate for the marketplace right now is that they pick and choose and they cherry pick and choose things that are just going to make a gazillion dollars. So if you're not going to make a gazillion dollars, they're not going to go for the indie films that were popular, you know, 15 years ago, 20 years ago, which was a golden age for indie film, where these offbeat movies got made. It's not the time where big studios want to make these offbeat indie films. So now you have to say, at least at this moment, we, for this particular project, we said, how small can we make it so we can go to actors and say, it's really going to happen? Because when we go with the script and say, we don't know how it's going to happen, can we get you to attach yourself and then run out and get money? Most people say no. Why? Because when that actor attaches themselves to a project and then you run around and try to get made and everyone tells you no, their value goes down mm-hmm. as an actor. So that's the problem. And the agents are saying, don't you dare attach yourself to this project that has no money. So it's the catch-22. Like, you want a cast, you want money, you want a cast, you want money. So it is a tricky situation to be in. It's an interesting time. So, I think it's going to change.
So the rule is, if you have no money, make a movie.
Make a movie with no money.
Make a movie with no money.
With no money. Don't make a movie with no
money. It's about Thanksgiving.
It's about Thanksgiving in some way.
Or something. Make it about something you really care about, and then... And then really good luck too, because I feel it. I feel your pain.
It's a fantastic
Nancy
film.
And Rich, thank you very
thank
much
you
for
so
coming
much.
Out
thank
tonight.
You for coming.
Thank you, guys. Thank you for
Kristi.
And thank you to the Rivertown Film Society. Continued success, really.
And Kristi, thank you for leading us in a fascinating discussion tonight.